So let's talk about order. People love putting things together in a way that's neat and pretty and easy. Arranging things is literally part of being alive. And it's no different when it comes to language. Our brains go through the same steps every time. From hearing the sounds to understanding what language thing just happened, our lobes up here follow an orderly path to do their magic. So let's follow them down. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
So every time we hear some language, every time we read something, our brains have to really quickly work out what we're doing. Speech comes at us fast, and if we don't respond just as fast, we won't understand what's happening. Just take a look at our videos. We're talking at an average of 165 words a minute. That's 2.75 words per second. Our brains have to be flying to deal with that fast talk. And that's why when we talk about neural responses to language, we discuss it in terms of milliseconds. That's thousandths of a second. But before we go traveling down those neural pathways, we have to talk about a problem that we can't avoid when we go poking around the brain looking for any particular thing that it does. And that's that the brain is a super busy place. It's not just waiting idly by, hoping some stray sounds will swing its way. It's got to do everything for managing your continued life. Your breathing, your heart, your background thoughts, your brain helpfully and thanklessly manages all of that for you. You might think that your brain would be a Ravenclaw, but it's really more of a Hufflepuff. With all this frantic activity going on all the time, though, we have to be super careful that any changes that we see happening have to do with language, and not, like, worrying about Quidditch or something. If we want to look at the progress the brain is making with processing sentences, we need to take a continuous measurement. Just look at what it's doing all the time. Which means we can use electroencephalograms, or EEGs. EEGs track the brain's activity by measuring small changes in the electric field the brain emits through the skull, and we can look at those in real time. But just that ongoing measurement isn't enough. After all, your brain is abuzz all the time. So what linguists do is time-lock the presentation of any given sound or word to a few hundred milliseconds of brain activity. Within the recording of everything that's happening brain-wise, we measure the small changes that happen because of the stimulus the person heard or read. These changes are so tiny, we measure them in microvolts. That's a millionth of a volt. And since you could still be thinking about your potions homework rather than our stimulus, we average across a large number of examples to strip away that variation. Because we're measuring changes in the brain's electric field that are responses to specific things that happened, these are known as event-related brain potentials, or ERPs. So what sorts of effects do we find? What happens before what else in the brain? We probably expect that the first thing we register is that we heard some sounds that were language-y. And that's what the first ERP effects are thought to show us. They happen really soon after you hear a sound. A negative bump 100 milliseconds after, known as the N100 effect, and then a positive spike, known as the P200. These effects are centered around the centroparietal region, like over here. They make a combined reaction that tells you that you just heard a sound, and particularly a meaningful and unexpected sound. And these effects are really attuned to phonology. For example, if you've been hearing a lot of words that start with B, like buck, beak, and broomstick, and then suddenly you get a word that starts with a nice puffy P, like potion, you'll get a much bigger N100. The N100 even happens if you're asleep. It's a little bit slower, but it means you'll be able to register the change in the sounds around you and know if a magical creature is coming for you in the night. After we get past the effects for just sounds, the next step down our orderly path is to get the meanings of our words. We can find how the brain deals with integrating semantics into our sentences another couple tenths of a second down the line. This shows up again in the centroparietal region, about 400 milliseconds after you hear the word. It's known as the N400. The N400 was first found in 1980 by looking at sentences that were completely normal, except for this one weird word that would throw people off. Like, let's consider how we could end a sentence like, Dumbledore attended a party wearing a hat and... blank. So what should go in the end there? Well, there's probably all sorts of words you could think of, but you'd probably never come up with cake. It's not that it's wrong, exactly. It's still a well-formed sentence. That's a place for a noun like cake to go. So when you put it in there, no warnings go off to tell you that the whole thing is unacceptable now. But it's just ridiculous. A man like Dumbledore is no place for a cake to be worn. And your brain struggling to fit in this randomness gets shown to us as a big ol' N400 spike. What if you have something a bit more normal than that? If it's at least something you could wear, but not something that you would expect, like, say, stilts, you still get an N400, but it's not as big. And the most normal thing, like the word you'd predict to go in there, say something like robe, that doesn't get much of an N400 at all. The harder it is to fit the word in, the bigger the N400. So the N400 is argued to reflect the cost of semantic integration, like fitting in a word. You find it all over the place, but it only gets big when things get weird. So finally, the last step down the path is when you have your sounds and your meanings, and you want to make sure that you checked off all the boxes right for the syntax of your sentence. If you missed something or you mucked about with the sentence, you get the last of the effects we'll talk about today, the P600. The P600 is a positive shift about 600 milliseconds after the word in question. It's in the same brain region as the other effects, and it's huge. It's strong, and it lasts for a long time after the problem passes by, like the better part of a second. What kind of syntactic issues make your brain explode like that? Well, these are sentences that are missing the right syntactic markers. Take, our hero Neville pull the sword from the hat. Now, for English, that pull is just wrong. It has to be pulls, or pulled, or something, but just plain pull is right out. When your brain slides past pull and checks the syntax, it notices there's nothing on the verb, and it flares right up. We can also see P600s occurring for grammatical violations of case marking, the pieces around nouns that tell you what role they fill in the sentence. So maybe you want to say, Ron drinks the butterbeer in German. That'd be, Ron trinkt das Butterbier. And the das marks the Butterbier as the object in the sentence. If you swap out that das for a different case, like Ron trinkt dem Butterbier, German brains can't take the bad syntax. It's not that you can't work out what the meaning here is. In both cases, it's 100% clear what's trying to be said. But the syntax doesn't work, and we really do care about syntax, down to our brains. That's what the P600 tells us. So ERP effects can show us the way we impose order on our linguistic world, from sound to meaning to syntax. By looking at what's going wrong when we mess with sentences, we can get a sense of how we approach language when it's going right. Even though we still have a long way to go to work out all the intricacies of language in the brain, the knowledge we've gained from ERPs so far lights up the way. So we've reached the end of the Ling Space for this week. If you weren't thrown off by the sudden cake, you learned that we can see how the brain deals with language by time-locking our stimuli to neural reactions, that the N100-P200 complex responds to sounds in the environment and their phonology, that the N400 stems from your brain trying to deal with weird words and fitting them into the sentence, and that the P600 is your brain's way of telling you that something went horribly wrong with the syntax. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman. It's directed by Adélise Prévost, and it's written by both of us. Our production assistant is Georges Coulomb, our music and sound design is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook, and if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling Space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Annyeong!